Good afternoon to all.
Good afternoon, sir.
So, I was just discussing with sir. So today morning you had 2-hour session of reading Economic Times, Business Standard and all those things. I think many of you must be reading for the first time, right? So, let's have an interactive session today. And the topic which I'm going to discuss today, like in the first presentation, you heard about the technology related to finance, the technology related to those industries, etc. like that. I'm going to talk about the technologies and the improvements that is needed for a city. Now, when I say technology and improvements needed for a city, you must have all read. So, in today also there was some news items in Business Standard, Economic Times about the smart cities. It is one of the flagship scheme of the Honorable Prime Minister of India and the Government of India. 100 cities have been selected under the smart cities program. So today in my entire presentation, what I want to convey to you is what is this scheme all about? How are the cities of India transforming? How as students you can take part in the scheme as of now to build your career? What are the opportunities available for me, you and all of us as a whole in your own respective cities? At present, what is the stage of that scheme? What are the projects envisaged and what is going to come up? And how the finances of the city are going to be raised? And some of the smart solutions which have been implemented or going to be implemented in those cities. Like basically to tell the background, I've been working on around 12 to 13 such cities under the smart cities mission. So one of the prime city that I worked was Surat in Gujarat. You all must be aware, which got rank number 4 in the smart city challenge competition. So I'll tell in detail what is that competition all about and other things like that. But before getting into the details of that presentation, according to you, what is the definition of a smart city? Some of you might be knowing certain in bits and pieces and this thing. And before me asking you the question, let me tell you this also. There is no textbook or copybook definition of a smart city. So I just wanted to know from you, based upon your perspective of your city where you live in, or the city now you present, or where you have been born and brought up, if that city needs to be called smart, then how would you define it?
Technologically advanced,
well planned. I want the answer from the last row.
So good governance. Good governance.
Good governance.
All the resources available.
Infrastructure.
Infrastructure,
technology, pollution free. If someone can take down this, at the end of this thing you will get lot of points. Because all these are relevant points.
Employment.
Someone told something on international and India.
Good connectivity of air or railway from international level.
Okay. No, technology is there, pollution free is there, helipad is there, smart people should be there. But are we missing something basic in all these smart cities? Someone told infrastructure. Yeah, someone told that also. The basic thing of 24/7 water supply. 24/7 power supply. Good, one important aspect, security. Financially stable, good, that I'll cover it. How a city can be financially stable? A majority of the cities are financially much unstable. And the city where you are in, Pune, it is one of the cash-rich corporation that was, recently they have issued municipal bonds also. When you read through the pink papers, around You can search in Google also. Pune was one of the first municipal corporations under the smart city scheme to issue municipal bonds of 200 crores, and which has been oversubscribed 3 times. So what they have done is that they have securitized the entire property tax they are going to receive in the next 5 years' time. So we received various aspects of what a city, in order to call it smart, should be. So now this smart city as a phenomenon or as a concept is nothing new. It has been happening in the Western world, it has been happening abroad at various places. If you see Barcelona, if you see Denmark, Copenhagen, all those places the smart city mission and the smart city schemes have been going on time and time, and majority of the projects have been implemented, etc. like that. But what the government of India thought was that in order to make it Indianized, the Indian cities, in order to be called smart, rather than bringing in, first of course, I'll come to the technology part later. First of all, let that basic infrastructure and the basic minimum living standards for the citizens, can the city administration provide to the citizens of the city? When I say minimum living standards, at least basic roads, water supply, power, electricity, like that. So the basic platform or the basic foundation of the smart city scheme is laid on of how to create better infrastructure. Now, when I say create better infrastructure, it doesn't mean that go and load lot of capex into the city, load put water supply pipeline of say another 300, 400 crores, which will again start non-functioning after 3-4 years like that. There are certain existing infrastructure already laid in the city. By using certain ICT solutions, by using certain technology solutions, how we can get the maximum benefit of the existing layer infrastructure in the city. One simple example I will tell you. Pune Municipal Corporation has a lot of city bus services. And you know what is the status of that. Like that, many of the cities under the JNURM scheme, they have got many city bus services. Now, you don't know what are the bus timings. You don't know at which bus stop what bus number is going to come. To pay the fare also it is big. So by using the ICT technology, if with automated GPS system, with automated bus passenger the vehicle location system, smart bus stops, with automatic fare collection systems, etc. The existing infrastructure or the existing transportation system which is there, how we can get the double and the triple benefits of the already that infrastructure. This one small example I told. Another example is that, for example, Pune must have at least 25 to 30 multi-level car parking or the parking spaces. Now, someone who is living in Pune, if I ask you, where are the parking spaces available in the city? You might know one or two, rest you may not know. Suppose if an app is there, which tells you, as someone who is coming from Mumbai or some other city, enters into Pune, logs into that app, it tells that within 2 kilometers, there is a car parking facility available, in that 3 lots are vacant. Or if it is not vacant, so it saves a lot of time, it saves a lot of fuel, etc. and lot on this thing. So my point of telling was that one of the focus, when we as a consultants, when we prepared the smart city challenge proposals for various cities, one of the mandate given to us by the government was that to identify those kind of minimal capex requirement by which the existing infrastructure's benefit can be reaped by the citizens. Can you? Akshat, can you go to that PDF fifth page? So now what I'll do is that I'll take you first through that scheme of Government of India first. Like what has the cities done so far? And out of the 100 cities selected, what happened was that there was a, what government felt was that in the earlier government schemes, now what happened was that they identify a scheme, you prepare a report, you give certain amount of money is transferred to the city or that particular institution. And then it leads to a lot of pilferage, leakages, etc. So what government thought was that, let us create a competition between the cities. Let us create among the administration that I am getting the funds because I have done something, I participated in a competition, I prepared a plan. Like you must have been going for business plan competitions, etc. and all. So every city had to prepare a smart city plan, which went into a competition. And in that competition, cities were ranked. Some international expert like Bloomberg Philanthropies, etc. There was a jury created, and each cities were scored and marked. And the first 20 cities were declared around a year before. And the rank one was got by Bhubaneswar, and the rank 2 was got by Pune, and third by Jaipur, fourth by Surat, etc. like that. So like that, in that competition, as of now, 60 cities has been selected. And now, each of these cities' plan is available in the website smartcities.gov.in. It is a very informative website. I'll try to be loud. In that smartcities.gov.in, each of those plans of each of these 63 cities selected is available in that website. So now, as a student, how that should interest you to go and look at that. In that plan, there is a marketing component there. There is an HR element there in terms of capacity building, training, etc. and all. There is a finance element there, the entire city's financial plan, how to make the city financially sustainable, and told financially sustainable it should be there, how the funds can be raised, what are the innovative ways of raising finance for a city. The ballgame is entirely different when you go to raise finance for a city or when you go to raise finance for an urban local body. Then the operations part is there. So for each of you, what interest, that sections are there. There is a set of 46 questions which was given to each of these cities. So under the smartcities.gov.in, all those cities' plans are there. So go visit it and read it. It is really a storehouse of information. You will see how innovative solutions each of these cities are there. To start with, you can refer to the Pune Smart City Challenge proposal, which was prepared by McKinsey & Company. Now, this was the thing. So the major aims of those mission, I'm not getting into the theoretical part of it, the mission transformation comprehensive, putting people first, aspirational, competitive convergence. Now, one important aspect of the smart city scheme is that each of those cities which is selected, Government of India allocates 1,000 crores to each of these cities, out of which 500 crores is put in by the state government and the ULB, and the 500 crores is brought in by the Government of India. And there is a method for convergence. What all Government of India and state government schemes are available for the infrastructure development of a city, all are converged and dovetailed under the umbrella of the Smart City Mission. Now, I don't know if you are aware of the other government schemes, like Amrut Mission is there, there are Affordable Housing Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana is there, PMAY scheme is there, like a lot of schemes are there. So as consultants, what was our mandate was that to identify all those schemes which are there and dovetail it and make it suitable as per each of these cities. Because different cities, the dynamics would be different. In certain cities, mobility would be an issue. In certain cities, water supply would be an issue. In certain cities, connectivity would be an issue. In certain cities, the percentage constituents of urban poor would be an issue. So the strategies for making the city smart would be different from city to city. That's why if you go through these plans of each of these cities, you will know how it is there. And many of your native places would have also been selected. So there you can correctly locate to that particular area where you have already seen, and then you can understand what plans have been suggested by the various consultants, because various urban planners, finance experts, all have put and sat in their hours and years of experience together and prepared that plan. Next slide. Since it's a PDF, we'll have to do page down. So, I think before this also one was no problem. So now what happened was that one of the biggest hiccups that these ULBs were facing, or these government institutions were facing, was that lack of manpower. Some of them told that good governance is a problem. So that governance structure, when you go to I don't know how many of you must have gone to a municipal corporation office in India. So when you go to the municipal corporation office, the first thing is that what comes in your mind is that I should not come back here again. So that is the thing. So that thing, how it can be improved? How can a corporate setup be brought into this ULB culture? So each of these smart cities which was selected, they had to form a special purpose vehicle registered under Companies Act 1956, now it is 2013. So it will be a corporate company setup. For example, Pune. Pune has an SPV called Pune Smart City Limited, PSCL. And it has a corporate CEO, it has a chief technological officer, it has a CFO, which is brought in by the market, which is brought in from the market, not the government cattle people. So it's a pure corporate setup which is there to implement these smart city projects. Any of you know in Pune where that smart city activities are happening now? Any idea? In that Aund Baner area is the area that is selected. So that was one thought process related to the professional setup of executing the smart city. And in this, the government of India, state and ULB will have the maximum shareholding. And in order to bring in private players into it, the private players can take an equity in this SPE. Whoever wants to, through a competitive tendering process, so the likes of MIT, Sharpuji's or the Hitachi's or the system integrators can come in and take an equity in this SPV for the implementation of this project. And now, how the scheme was for that, in every city, a particular area would be selected. It is called area-based development. So every city has, as of now, on an average, every city has prepared a plan of around 2,200 to 2,400 crore in an average. So now what happens is that if this 2,300 crore is spread across the city, the visibility and impact of those 2,300 crore would be minimal. So what was decided was that a particular area in the city of around 800 to 700 acres would be selected. And the entire plan would be implemented there first. That area would be made smart. So the other, the citizens living in the other areas would also feel that my area should also become smart. So the innovative means of financing like betterment tax for them, increase in property tax for that particular area like that can be implemented. So in every city, when you go through this plan, there will be one area-based development proposal and one pan-city proposal. Pan-city is for the entire city. So that was the thing. Now this is, you can skip. So this is how the entire smart city challenge plans, that basic fundamentals were there. Incorporation of NSPV, area-based development, pan-city development. So now, like this, the first step when we did for preparing the smart city challenge, and this is the template that was given by the Ministry of Urban Development. So one of the things what we did was that, what is the present status of that city? So for any plan, for any strategy that you suggest, made for a company, made for a firm, or made for an urban local body, you need to know what is the present status and what is the present strength of the city. So initially 1 month, we spent going to various departments to collect and to know what is the operational efficiency of the city, what is the traffic situation, what is the water supply, the supply levels, what is the solid waste management collection levels, how the solid waste management is processed, the mobility, how it is there, and we benchmarked it with the national and the international standards. And then we decided, based upon that city's strength and the aspiration, where it has to be. On all these parameters, it may not be able to reach all those national and the international benchmarks level. So depending upon the finance available, depending upon the capacity of the administration, we decided that in this, for so-and-so scenarios, we will move 2 levels. So-and-so scenarios, we will move 5 levels. We will be the best. For example, in Surat, where I work, one of the thing was that, one of the mandatory conditions for the smart city was that at least 10% of the energy consumed should be from the renewable energy. But when we discussed with Surat, Surat's already 40% of the electricity of the municipal corporation was met through renewable energy sources only. So what we decided as a plan of that, in the next 3 years or 4 years down the line, 100% of the electricity consumption will be from the renewable energy, and that will be the first municipal corporation in Asia to be declared as a green corporation. So those are the kind of strategies which so my point of view was of telling is that, so that is the linking of the existing scenarios and from where you are to where you want to be, and then defining the strategies based upon that. Otherwise what will happen is that whatever strategies and advices that you give, it will be off the air. One of the biggest complaints of the management graduates, even I am one, so they tell that they talk out of the air. They talk all those strategies which are unimplementable, which are not linked to the ground level situation. So that ground level assessment, for anything that you do, that ground level assessment, that existing scenario, and that aspiration and ambitions of where to be. These two block, these two points have to be fixed first, and then decide on the plan of action and other things like that. Now, this is how we did the self-assessment and all those things. Now, this is a long thing. I'm not getting into the details of how that smart city plan was prepared. Can you go to that PPT? There are some of the smart solutions which I wanted to present before you, which can give you a food for thought. And I'll tell you an interesting example, how students had contributed. Well, now we are doing the implementation of the Lucknow Smart City project. So there one of the students of the engineering college, what he said was that there are around 300 to 350 sulabh shauchalayas in the entire Lucknow city. So it was, the condition was quite dilapidated, no one knew when the cleaning took place, contractors were appointed, there was no one to monitor and all those things. So a student came up with an idea. He set up a kind of a feedback mechanism. There are only three buttons in that. Good, ugly, bad, that kind of a thing. So everyone who uses that toilet will press on that button and automatically that feedback will go to that solid, that health inspector, sanitation inspector in charge, and even it will go to the mobile of the commissioner of that municipal corporation. The Lucknow Nagar Ayukt will get that this day. So every day morning when he logins into his app, into his mobile, he gets these much toilets are dirty. This is the feedback. The contractor has not gone and cleaned over there. So he can pull up the contractor over there. And if you see in at least 3 to 4 months, this is the actual this thing. Actually, at least in 3 to 4 months, the cleanliness level were actually increased from around, say, if you say 15 to 20% to at least 50 to 60%, if not more. So those are the some kind of unique, small, cost-effective solutions that can be implemented in the cities, which is there. And whoever has interest in the IT and the ICT technologies, there is also a scheme of Government of India under Ministry of Urban Development also, that whichever idea is there, they finance you to set up that startups under the Startup India scheme and link it with the Smart City Mission, and they will help you to set up a pilot in one of these cities also, by which it can be replicated across the other cities. So this I have already explained, skills, investments and all. So now one of the things, I tried to put it a little graphical so that it will be a little interesting for you. Now, first related to the smart transportation. Now, go to the next slide. The earlier slide, so what I wanted to show was that, suppose, one of the major problems that the cities face now is related to the new cars getting increased day by day on road and other things like that. So you enjoy your new car. This is how a new car, everyone gets happy. Go to the next slide. Now, in the planning of the city, how majority of the traffic engineers see your city is that the car occupies the maximum amount of space, then followed by the other modes of transport. I don't know whether you can see walking less, cycle, public transport system, two-wheelers, etc. But ideally, it has to be this way around, where public transportation, pedestrianization should be given majority of the focused impact on. So in these smart city challenge proposals, where we have suggested on majority of the cities, public bicycle sharing scheme is one of the majority of the cities have suggested public bicycle sharing scheme. And Bhopal is one of the cities where it has already implemented, it has started around 2-3 weeks before, along with the ICT systems and all those things like that. So this is also, when you're interested in the statistics and who wanted to do further research and get into that, they will be there. So percentage of passengers by mode, which is there, and percentage of road occupied by mode also, which is there. So I just wanted to show what is the realistic and the idealistic scenario. And now, transportation, it is not a technical problem. Then what is it? It is a matter of public policy. Now, as per the public policy, what you can do, I don't know, many of you might be, after this, must be getting into some firms which are into city governance, or some of them will be getting into consulting firms, etc. and all. So these kind of thought process is quite important when you actually go in and suggest a particular idea to a particular city, etc. building flyovers to solve traffic congestion is like loosening your belt to fight for obesity. Self-explanatory. Okay. Now, using road space efficiently. This is also self-explanatory. So what I wanted to convey, of course, that
ground is not visible. If you see the various modes and what is the capacity of passengers per hour. So in each of those modes, the capacity of passengers per hour is there. So going for the solutions where the maximum passengers per hour per direction capacity is there. We call it PPH, passengers per hour capacity. So when you go the niche, the last one, which is hidden, that is the metro rail and all those things. But you see, majority of the cities are coming up with the metro rail. Already in 8 cities it is there. Pune also is under construction. Click here. Now, this is it. Now, parking demand, what normally happens? When there is more parking demand, more parking supply, and bigger traffic jams. And the open spaces go, and all those things go. And so our general tendency is that if there is more parking demand, create more multi-level car parking spaces. It leads to again and again more cars. So we are being a vicious part of the problem. We are not creating an end-to-end solution for that. Next. See, one parking space is an interesting scenario. One parking space is 23 to 28 square kilometer. What does that mean? It means dining space for 15 people, office space for 4 people, one affordable housing unit. So the thought which I wanted to leave with you is that whether you need space for that or whether you need more parking spaces in the city. And parking is a commodity, not a right. It comes with a price. So, go to the next slide. So in this, what I wanted to convey is whether prioritize the pedestrians. Next. See, parking has a cost of 20 to 60 rupees per hour. So one of the ideal majority of the cities, what we suggested was that to increase the parking fees. So that more amount of carpooling, and now with the advent of this Uber, Ola and all those things like that, and how that last mile connectivity using this Uber, Ola, etc. and all can be done. For example, if a city has a metro, how the routes of Uber and Ola along with the cycle rickshaws, for cycle rickshaws now here won't be there, but in states, in the major cities like UP and all, cycle rickshaws are also there. So how integrating this Uber, Ola, cycle rickshaws, metros, etc., the last mile connectivity till your home is established. So that, because it, just by telling that you have to use public transport, citizens are not going to use public transport. Until and unless efficient public transport and the last mile connectivity is provided. Next. Next. So high demand, high user fee, not more supply. Even in the taxis, you have the surge pricing, similar kind of concepts. And these are the transport policy. Anyone who is interested in transportation as a career and other things, you know, we can discuss further on it. There are a lot of interesting case studies, stories, etc. and all. Where you can do, where how under sustainable finances, how a sustainable transport policy is prepared, how the operational management of a transport policy is prepared. In a moment, I just want to leave you with certain food thoughts, that these are the areas where you can open up your mind and think, where the options and opportunities are available in plenty and huge. Now, to make it the fact more interesting, I'll tell you the career opportunities over here, which is going to come up in the next 2 years down the line. In each of these cities, they are appointing a project management consultant. And each project management consultant need to depute at least 10 people in these cities permanently for the next 5 years. So you can imagine 100 into 10, that is the kind of professionals that is going to come up in the next 3 years down the line, in terms of the opportunities related to the people in this sector. This is giving priority to walking, cycling, public transport. So earlier what happened was that it was, the pyramid was upside down. The bottom one was on top. So what we are suggesting is that turn the pyramid upside down, where pedestrianization is given more priority. This, I'm not getting into the details of it. You can keep on clicking. Bicycle sharing systems, the GIS enabled systems and all those things. How that IT component can come into it. coming on to the intelligent transport system. Pune already has a command and control center in place. L&T is doing that command and control center, where their security surveillance system, bus location, everything is there. For example, I'll tell you a matter of what would be the impact or importance of this command and control system. Suppose a water supply system, there is a leakage. Now what happens is that some citizen need to phone and tell that corresponding engineer, and that corresponding engineer will phone his boss and like that, so it takes a lot of time. But with the SCADA-based systems in water supply, as soon as a leakage is detected in the command and control center, that alarm is raised. In so-and-so particular road and so particular junction, this is there, and he sees it in the screen. So automatically, based upon the scale of the problem, it is sent to chief engineer or the corresponding engineer, and within minutes, that team reaches on the site. So that is how that IT systems can enable to do it. Then coming on to what water supply like that the presentation goes on. The thing what I want to convey at this point of time is that in each of these sectors, there are a kind of smart solutions, the frugal innovations available, and there are a lot of small non-capex oriented solutions which will be there. So it's very difficult to convey all the solutions at the minimum point of time. So what I'll conclude by telling that what you can do is that, as I told earlier, start by reading those smart city plans of those cities. Of course, if majority of the students are of the finance specialization over there, there are specific chapters on the financing plan of those cities, how those are created from various schemes, how to raise innovative finance mechanisms. See, because now what happens is that Government of India is focusing very much on issuance of municipal bonds. So how do you analyze, as your summer project or summer dissertation, what you can do, take up one project is that. You can do the internship with the respective SPVs of these Pune Corporation or Mumbai or Thane, Kalyan, Dombivli. Go sit with the CFO of these SPVs, take their financial audited balance sheet, analyze those balance sheet, come up with the ideas. You never know. It may not be that the McKinsey's and the Bostons of the world might have the innovative solutions. In your mind, you might get some new innovative solutions which could be implemented. So do that financial analysis yourself. And now already ready-made plans are there, 65 of them. So, and then compare, based upon your financial analysis, how that stands. And so you will get to know how to analyze the municipal finances. And then, based upon that, how you can derive out the various financial instruments. Like Pune Municipal Corporation, if you Google it out, you will get any number of details of how that bond has been structured. So you will get to know how a debt instrument is structured. And it is a relevant practical example happening in the city which you are in. So make use of that, and so then you will get more and more practical insights and inputs. And many of you are first years also, so who will be doing that somewhere internship going down the line. So do such things which will have actually practical use, and which you can really show that on the ground, this is what I have done, and this is the suggestions that I have made. So based upon which, you will also feel satisfaction. And finally, when you sit with the report, you will also have that authority to say, haan, maine ye padha hai, maine ye kiya hai, maine ye suggest kiya hai, aur usme implement hota hai, toh it's a feather on your cap. Just click to the slides. So that is what I want to end my presentation. If any questions are there, I would like to take it.